Now Ramayya has, Professor Ramayya has made it really difficult for me because I am supposed to be ending at 5:40. There is some festival, student festival. So, I think I should get down to business. Over the next 12 to 14 hours, I will be giving you a helicopter survey, okay, of problems of development from an economic standpoint, okay, from an economic lens. This lecture we will look at basic concepts of development. What is the main metric of development? What are the indicators of development? What are their shortcomings? And what is the main problem of economic development and main problematic of development economics? Okay. Now, there are just one or two things. I encourage participation, so you can ask questions, you can seek clarifications, you can even make comments. But don't do it randomly, don't do it when I'm speaking, okay? Raise your hands and I'll take your question. Please don't jeer or clap, especially when I am discussing issues related to gender, to caste, issues of disability, okay? If you do that, I will be unforgiving. All right, so let's start. How do economists view underdevelopment? Who is underdeveloped? And therefore, I'm also asking, who is developed? What is the indicator of development? The first and foremost indicator of development is income. Okay. Income gives you command over food, over clothing, over shelter. Okay. So income gives you things that you need. Okay. And therefore, income certainly is an indicator of development. And therefore, if we have to classify a region as underdeveloped, which obviously means that you have to classify some other regions as developed, you can compare their incomes. Okay. Societies with higher incomes are richer or more developed. Okay. Regions with higher incomes are more developed. Okay. And so on and so forth. Or people with higher incomes are more developed. But how does income originate? Okay. By the way, some of you who have already studied economics would find it very elementary. Okay. So I'll try to make it interesting for you by throwing in a bit of history, okay, of illustrations that you may not be aware of, and so on and so forth. So, but what is, okay, so what is income a result of? How do people generate incomes? Income is simply a counterpart of production. Farmer generates his or her income by selling mangoes, by producing and selling mangoes, or apples, or wheat, whatever. I produce my income, or I generate my income by producing education. At least I would like to think so. Or a doctor generates his or her income by producing health. Okay? So, incomes are generated as a result of productive activity. It's an outcome of production. And therefore, one way of viewing income of, let's say, an economy is to look at the sum total of all goods and services produced in that economy. Okay? And that sum total of all goods and services for a country is called GDP, or gross domestic product. Okay? Sum total of all goods and services produced in the economy, and therefore, since income is the counterpart of production, it's also the sum total of all incomes generated in the economy. Okay? And it is the sum total of goods that you can use. Right? So sum total of goods that you produce, and therefore it's the sum total of all goods and services that you can use. Actually, not literally so. Because a part of what you produce gets consumed in the process of production. So coal goes into the production of iron, okay, or electricity. Okay. So what you have at the end of your production process is merely some kilowatts of electricity, because coal has been used up. Okay. So what matters, therefore, is actually not the sum total of all goods and services, but the sum total of net goods and services, or what economists call value added. Okay, so GDP is the same as value added. If you have produced, let's say, 100 rupees worth of furniture, okay, and you have separately produced 50 rupees worth of wood, but that wood has gone into production of furniture, so all that you have, the end of economic, all your economic activities, is 100 rupees worth of furniture. So your GDP is 100 rupees. It's 100 rupees worth of furniture you have produced. So don't take this proposition that GDP is sum total of all goods and services literally, because it's actually sum total of net goods and services. Okay, it's what you have after deducting intermediate inputs of various kinds. Are you following me? Okay. Too elementary, I suppose. So, secondly, production takes time. Okay? And therefore, GDP is a flow variable. It flows over it's how much you produce, let's say, in 6 months, or 1 year, or 2 years. Right, and therefore it is GDP cannot be mentioned without regard to the time dimension. Okay, so you can have GDP estimates for a year, or GDP estimates for 3 months, or GDP estimates for 6 months, and so on and so forth. Usually the practice is to look at GDP per annum, that is GDP for 1 year. Now, you can use GDP to effect intertemporal comparisons, that is, comparisons over time. If GDP increases over time, in some sense you've become more developed. That's the idea, because you have more goods and services available for use. Your income has increased. Some elementary calculations have to be done before you can effect comparison of GDP over time. A, you have to divide by population. Okay, let's say that your GDP is 10 apples. In real terms, it's 10 apples in 2014. Okay, and it increases to 20 apples in 2015. Okay, but in the meanwhile, your population also doubles. So for one individual, there has been improvement in income. Therefore, you always look at GDP per capita, okay, especially when you are comparing over time, because over time population changes. Usually it increases, but sometimes it can also decrease. Secondly, you have to normalize for prices. Okay, let's say, you see, GDP is an aggregation of diverse commodities. You know, you add up iron with electricity, with fruits, okay? And you cannot add them up in their physical quantities. So you need to add up their money values, okay? What they will fetch in the market. So one apple is priced at 10 rupees in market. So your GDP is not one apple, it's 10 rupees. Or rather, the apple contribution to your GDP is 10 rupees. Why? Because apples have to be added with mangoes, right? Or oranges. So GDP is always measured in money terms or rupee terms or dollar terms. But prices change over time. Okay, prices change over time. So you produce one apple in 2014, you continue to produce one apple in 2015, but in the meanwhile prices go up. Okay, it will appear that your GDP has increased, but not in real terms, only prices have gone up. So you need to normalize for prices by bringing all prices to common units. I should measure 2015's GDP in 2014's prices if I want to effect the comparison between the two, right? So yeah, so that's important. Have you understood it? It's simple. Similarly, okay, so if you're comparing GDP over time, you need to divide by prices or normalize for prices, and you need to normalize for population. Okay? Similarly, you may want to effect a comparison of GDP between countries. How do you, for example, know that Canada is more developed than India? Okay? Or Pakistan is less developed than China? How do you know that? One way of doing it would be to compare GDP per capita of these two countries. Okay? Now, there are some issues that arise in cross-sectional or inter-country comparison of level of development. A, GDPs of different countries are reckoned in terms of different currencies. Okay, so the American GDP data would be available in terms of dollars, Indian GDP data is available in terms of rupees, French GDP data is available in terms of francs or euros or whatever. So you need to bring different GDPs to a common currency denomination. All right? So let's say that, and these are all assumed figures, okay? Let's say that Canada's GDP is, or America's, US's GDP is $1, okay? And India's GDP is 30 rupees, okay? Now how do we compare these two? These are measured in terms of two different currencies. How do we effect a comparison between these two GDPs? One way of doing it, okay, and that's the most often used conversion factor, is to use market exchange rates. What is an exchange rate? It's the price of one currency in terms of another. Okay. So, for example, you have a dollar rupee market, okay, or a euro dollar market, okay, or a euro rupee market, okay. Prices of currencies in terms of each other are quoted in these markets. Okay, so let's say that the foreign exchange market quotes 60 rupees for every dollar. That is, if you want to buy dollars, you have to shell out 60 rupees and you'll get $1 in exchange. Okay, now it's a market that may not be visible to many of you. Because it's not like potatoes or cabbage or toys, okay? But if you go to a bank, especially multinational banks or some of these private banks, okay, you have different counters. You know, one will say mutual fund, the other will say gold, one will say foreign exchange. You know what happens on that foreign exchange counter? Currencies are swapped, currencies are exchanged, okay? So banks or foreign exchange dealers quote a price for foreign exchange and make that foreign exchange available at that quoted price. So there is a foreign exchange market. Okay, so you can obtain exchange rates from foreign exchange market. So let's say that this foreign exchange market establishes the following exchange rate between rupees and dollars. 60 rupees for every dollar. Okay. What is America's GDP? $1. What is India's GDP? 30 rupees. Okay. What is America's GDP in terms of rupees? 60 rupees. So after effecting this market exchange rate conversion, we can compare India's GDP with that of the United States. Okay. What do we find in this example? That American GDP is twice as that of India. Sometimes, and especially in the reading, some of the readings that I have given, you will come across this term called GNP, okay, which is gross national product, which is different from gross domestic product. How do you do it? How do you reach from one to the other? You add net incomes from abroad. You see, Indians generate incomes at home by producing apples at home. But some Indian workers work in West Asia. Okay? And they may be producing apples there. So their income should be added to India's GDP to arrive at India's GNP. Okay? So you understand, GDP is a locational concept. Okay? Whereas GNP is income accruing to Indian citizens, no matter where they live. Okay? So it's a juridico-legal concept. Okay? Income of Indians irrespective of where they live. Okay? As long as they're Indian citizens. Okay? So you shouldn't be including the income of NRIs in India's GNP, because they're not Indian citizens. Okay? Similarly, some foreigners may participate in economic activity in India and generate their incomes from that participation. Okay? So we should be deducting their incomes from India's GDP to arrive at India's GNP. So what is India's GNP? It's simply India's GDP plus incomes earned by Indians abroad minus incomes paid out by India to foreigners. Okay. So, all right. So I hope I have driven this basic point home, that income is an indicator of development. You can assess the income of an economy by looking at its GDP. GDP should be divided by population when you are effecting intertemporal comparisons or even cross-sectional comparisons, that is comparisons between countries. Okay, India's GDP is larger than Pakistan's GDP simply because India is a much bigger country. Okay, so if you want to compare development levels of India with that of development level of India with that of Pakistan, you should be normalizing for population. You should be dividing Pakistan's GDP by its population, and you should be dividing India's GDP with its population. So if you want to compare development over time or at a given point of time between countries, you should normalize for population. Okay, when you are effecting comparisons over time, you also need to normalize for prices. Okay, because prices change all the time. Okay. Similarly, when you are comparing at a point of time between countries, you also need to bring different GDPs to a common currency denomination using market exchange rate. Okay. Sometimes economists don't use market exchange rates. They use something called PPP, okay, or purchasing power parity. Okay. Why do they do it? They do it because market exchange rates are not a good indicator of prices in two countries. Okay? If exchange rate is, let's say, $1 to 60 rupees, it does not mean that representative bundle of commodities in India is 60 rupees, whereas a representative bundle of commodities in America is $1. In other words, it doesn't mean that 60 rupees worth of goods in India are equivalent to $1 worth of goods in the United States. Okay? So I don't want to get into it because otherwise it will become complicated. But sometimes purchasing power parity will be used. If you don't understand it, don't bother. If you still do, you can meet me, but I can't do it in this classroom. Questions?
Nice question.
Yes, you should, because as long as the person is a citizen of the country, okay, you see, there are two concepts, one of gross product and the other of net product. Okay, net product is net of any depreciation. Okay, similarly, if there is appreciation, net should be greater than gross. Okay, when you're making comparisons between gross product, okay, you needn't take changes in asset values into account. Okay, but if you're effecting comparison between net products or net national income, then you must take depreciation or appreciation of currency of asset values into account. Yeah. All right. So why was I doing this? Okay, why was I teaching you GDP? Okay, because I wanted to show this slide to you. Okay, and I'd says that the world is divided between some countries that have very high incomes, okay, and others with incomes that are extremely low. Okay, so this division between high income, middle income and low income comes from the World Bank. Okay, World Bank collects data, okay, or uses national data sets, and then divides countries between some that are high income, others that are medium income, still others that are low income. Okay, so you can say that high income are developed, middle income are middle developed, and low income are less developed. Okay, and what do you find? You find that in 2011, for example, high income countries of the world had per capita incomes that were nearly 8 times the income of an average person in low income countries. Okay, so there are, the world is unequal. Okay, world is unequal, and there are some countries that are developed where people earn high incomes, and there are others where income levels and levels of development are very low. That's the basic point I wanted to make. Now, two other things. There is a geographical concentration of poor countries. Okay? They are to be found mainly in sub-Saharan Africa, okay, South Asia, and perhaps Middle East and North Africa. Okay? Similarly, high income countries are to be found in Europe and North America. Okay? Problem is that if you just look at these two parts of the world economy, sub-Saharan Africa and South Asia, together they account for 36% or more of the world's population. Okay? So 36% of world's population lives in areas with per capita incomes less than $800. Okay, per capita GDP less than $800. Look at the high income part of the world. European Union is 19,600, but that's because, you know, there, you know, this masks inequalities within the European Union. Okay, Europe has some very rich countries like Germany, France, okay, Belgium, Netherlands. These are part of European Union. But look at the whole of Southern Europe, okay, especially Portugal, okay, or Greece, okay, large parts of Central Europe, okay. So this masks a certain degree of disparity within Europe, and if you were to focus entirely on the OECD or the more developed part of Europe, this figure would go much above the 19,000-1600 level at which it currently stands. By the way, do you know how to read tables, right? Or am I assuming too much? You can read tables. So what does this table show? Someone? You can read tables, very good. Okay, so the point is, okay, so European Union, $19,600 per capita, okay, just 7% of world's population. Together, European Union and North America account for just 12% of world's population. What does that say? It says that vast majority of world lives in poor countries, poorer parts of the world. Okay? By the way, what about India? $837, $18% of world population. So, and have we arrived? Are we already a superpower? We are indeed. Yeah. China again is much poorer, okay, to much poorer compared to European Union or North America, okay, although it has performed much better than India in the recent past. Yes. Why is China more developed than Madagascar? Much greater population. No, now you're bringing in an extraneous factor. You said population. More population means less income per capita. Okay? But you can complicate things. Brazil is a much larger economy than Bolivia. Okay? Bolivia has per capita income levels that are about 1/7, 1/8 of Brazil's per capita income levels. China is a much larger economy compared to, let's say, Madagascar. I don't know what is Madagascar's per capita GDP figure, but I'm sure it is nothing comparable to that of China. Okay, so you know there's a great degree of aggregation here. Okay, so do not infer things from it. Okay, do not infer results theory from it. Okay, the basic point is that there are developed countries and there are underdeveloped countries. Okay. Underdeveloped countries are large parts of today's Asia, today's Latin America, and today's Africa. And much of world's population, very large share of world's population, lives in these underdeveloped parts of the world. Okay? So, the first point is just following from the previous slide. An average North American earns 50 times her South Asian counterpart. Now, point is, has this inequality between nations always existed? Or is it a more recent phenomenon? Okay, more recent phenomenon in terms of long history of humanity. Okay? Why? So, the point is that while some amount of inequality between nations has always existed, current high levels of inequality were an outcome of a process that started about 200 years ago. Okay? I'll just establish it with some data. There was an extraordinary increase in per capita incomes in Western Europe, especially England, after the Industrial Revolution. Okay? And that's about sometime in the late 18th century. Okay? Amiyo Bakchi, a great economic historian, calls it the first axial age. Okay? And he dates it to sometime in the 1760s. Okay? What happens? Some countries develop, industrialize, increase their incomes, and a decisive gap opens up between the rich and the poor. Okay? So a decisive difference opened up between those that could follow England and those that could not do so. And as a result, the world economy was divided into a small group of countries with high and growing per capita GDP and incomes, and others with a stagnant economic pace. Okay? So inequalities between nations that we see today are an outcome of a historical process that started some 200 years or so ago. And what is the main question of economic development? It's the eradication of this international gap. Okay? So this, I hope, sets the stage for the next 10 to 12 hours. This data is from the work of Angus Maddison. Angus Maddison was an economic historian who spent his life collecting historical evidence, historical data on comparative performance of countries. Okay? And he has GDP series that starts from 1 AD. Okay? So he has series that starts from 1 AD, but that's only for a limited number of countries. Okay? But if we take his data from 1820 and let's say compare it with 2000, what do we find? This is, okay, Asia as a percentage of Western Europe is Asia's per capita GDP as a ratio of, or as a percentage of, Western Europe's per capita GDP. Okay? And let's compare 1820 with 2000. Okay? In 1820, we were about 47%, or roughly half of Western Europe's per capita GDP. In other words, an average Asian earned about half of an average Western European in 1820. Okay? What happened to this ratio by 2000? It fell, and it fell drastically. Okay? All the way from 47% to about 19%. Okay? So, in the course of 180 years, our relative position fell, and therefore, by definition, the relative position of the rest of the world improved. Similarly, compare Africa as a percentage of Western Europe. Africa was not doing as badly in the beginning of the 19th century. You see that? Africa was about one-third of European per capita GDP in 1820. It was reduced to less than 10%. In fact, just 7.5% by 2000. Okay? So today you see a world that is unequal, okay? But it was not always so. Of course, you can argue that even in 1820, we only earned about half of what the Europeans did or the Americans did, okay? But if I were to figures backward, okay, disparity would reduce even further. And as I will just point out, income is not everything.
income is not everything. You have to look at how people are faring. Okay? Are they leading a healthy life? What is happening to the population? Is population falling because of high death rates? Okay? Because of disease, because of poor nutrition? Okay? And on some of these counts, the Chinese, for example, did much better than most European countries in the 18th century. Okay? China was the only part of the world. We only have historical evidence for very few countries, but we have historical evidence for China and we have historical evidence for England. Before 1760, China along with England were two parts of the world where population was in fact growing. Okay? And population growth is an important indicator of development. Why? Because you see, as you develop, nutrition improves, health facilities extend. I'll take a question. Health facilities expand. Okay? People have higher incomes, so they can afford a house over their head. For all these reasons, death rate falls. Okay? But population growth is an outcome of excess of birth rates over death rates. Right? Isn't it? You should give birth to more number of people than are dying. Okay? So birth rates must exceed death rates for population to grow. Okay? And in the recorded human history, the very first such instance of population growth is to be found in China and Europe. Okay? So similarly, it's not just output but the composition of output which matters a great deal. Okay? By the mid-18th century, or even till the mid-18th century, before gaps begin to widen, China and India together accounted for about half of world's manufacturing output. Okay? This is work done by Paul Byrok. He's a noted economic and industrial historian. So even till the middle of the 18th century, okay, India, China, parts of Africa, Asia were not performing as badly in relative terms. Okay? So current high levels of international inequality, that's my first submission, are an outcome of a historical process that started about 200-250 years ago. Okay. It was a product of colonialism, partly. But that was still our GDP.
Africa was still Africa.
Okay, you can still identify a landmass as Africa. Okay, even if the concept of nation state had not arisen, you could still call that certain landmass Africa. Okay, so we were producing resources, but a part of our resources were transferred to other parts of the world. Okay, so our GNP fell below our GDP. Okay, but that was still our GDP, right? Don't do that. Make it shorter. Just assume, you just constructed the example to show that two families with equal per capita incomes. But they are not equal. They are not equal per capita incomes, right? No.
So one, okay, so for the same level of income, you can have different ratios of consumption and savings. Obviously, the economy or the household that saves more will grow at a rate that is faster than, right? But since per capita income ratios have fallen, what does that say? It says that Western Europe, for example, has grown at a faster rate than Asia. That's all it says, right? That's it. Okay. We can have this discussion after the class. All right. Is this clear? Clear? Okay, so rapid industrial growth of some countries was an important factor in increasing their per capita incomes, but high per capita incomes in turn became a source of hegemony of a group of nations over others. I think this is pretty much self-explanatory. Do you want some examples? Historical examples? Okay, let me just quickly give some historical examples. Okay, by the way, it's a cumulative mechanism, okay? Rapid industrial growth in turn is a result of dominance of one set of nations over another, okay? But once you grow, you take a lead, okay? You set into motion a cumulative process, okay? You dominate even more, okay? Not necessarily. There are phases of capitalism, but I'll come to your point, because otherwise, I'll get disturbed. So some countries. So it's a cumulative process. But let me give you an example. Most people argue that, you know, for example, if you look at historically, you know, the late 18th or early 19th century, industrial revolution in England, okay, demanded heavy doses of fixed investment. Okay, why is investment difficult? Investment is difficult because if you want to invest, you need to save, which means that you can't consume. Okay, but after all, you produce to consume, and at low levels of income, especially when you're poor, it's difficult to resist consumption. Okay, I eat only two chapatis. Okay, now you ask me to eat only one. Okay, it'll be very difficult for me, right? So at low levels of income, it's difficult to resist consumption. Okay, and therefore. And how do you grow? But how do you grow? You grow by investment. Okay? You grow by investment. You expand your productive capacity. And, however, if you can tap someone else's income, okay, then you don't need to reduce your consumption. Right? Let's say that it's a corn economy. Okay, you can either consume corn or plant corn. Okay, and I have 10 kilograms of corn. Okay, let's say that I consume 6 kilograms of my own corn. I consume 6 kilograms of my corn and plant the other 4. Okay, that increases my productive capacity in future, because 4 kilograms of corn that is planted today will give me more corn in future, right? But let's say that I can also use corn produced in India or in Africa. Okay, so without reducing my consumption, I can increase my investment. Okay, so colonialism, okay, which started sometime, let's say, if you take the Indian case, okay, late 18th century, okay, that's when we date the beginning of colonialism too. That benefited England, okay, by increasing its command over our savings, our resources, okay, and therefore contributed to their economic growth. But once England became industrialized and powerful, it could dictate policies to the rest of the world. Okay, for example, England wanted large parts of the developing world in the 1840s and 50s to open up its trade.
Okay, open up it straight. When they refused to, most countries just followed England's dictates. But where they refused, England, because it was a developed country, because it was a powerful country, could send its gunboats. Okay, so the rule of international diplomacy in the 19th century was 5% and no more. Okay, which meant that countries can only charge 5% import tax and no more, which means that they were open to sale of goods produced in England. They should import freely from England. And their imports from England then enriched England even further. So it's a cumulative process. Okay? So I should ideally be saying that dominance of one set of countries over others resulted in their higher industrial growth. That higher industrial growth in turn contributed further to their dominance in world affairs. I'll do that when I take up colonialism in a separate lecture. Okay? So, on the other hand, for developing countries, growth in general and industry growth in particular was stunted by colonialism, but it was not colonialism alone. Okay? There were adverse domestic factors as well. Okay? So lack of supporting domestic and international factors stunted their growth. Okay? Therefore, gaps opened up. All right. I'll also come to that later. Right now, I don't have time. Okay. Now I will say something that many of you will not like. Okay. And I enjoy doing this every year. More industry means higher per capita income. So industry is good for development. Of course, I'm going to qualify my positions, especially this one, as I go along. But just look at these two graphs. Okay? All right. Blue is agriculture. Red is industry. Yellow is manufacturing, which is a part of industry. And green is services. Okay? So, agriculture is agriculture. Right? You know what is agriculture. What is industry? Industry includes manufacturing, which is your factory-based production, plus utilities of different kinds. Okay, electricity is not produced in a factory, but it is still a part of industry. Okay, waterworks are not done within a factory, but it's a part of industry. All right. So industry is a broader figure than just manufacturing. India's national income data classifies construction as a part of industry. Okay, but construction is of course not a factory-based activity. Okay, so industry is a broader category compared to manufacturing. So you can just forget the yellow bar. Okay. So just look at the three bars. Agriculture, you know what agriculture is. Services is everything else. Okay. It's the residual sector. All right. You know what is industry. You know what is agriculture. Everything else is services. Okay. What I'm doing is services. What doctors do is services. Transport is services. Hotels, restaurants, services. Okay? So, you know what is agriculture, you know what is industry. Everything else is services. That is your residual sector. Okay? And I have made this comparison between. So the graph on the left side, that is the four bars on the left hand side, are high income countries. Okay? Four bars on the right hand side are low income countries. Okay? Now, look at the height of the red bar in the case of high-income countries. It's much higher than the red bar in the case of low-income countries. Look at the blue bar in the case of high-income countries. Compare it with the blue bar in the case of low-income countries. What do you get? You get... Okay, now, by the way, what are these bars? They are share of these sectors, shares of different sectors in total GDP, in the sum total of what you produce. Okay, so a high blue bar means agriculture has a very high share in GDP. Okay, so for low income countries, agriculture contributes very highly to GDP. Okay, for high income countries, look at agriculture, it's way below 5% of GDP. Okay, much of their output comes either from industry or from services. Okay, is this clear? So what does international evidence show? It shows that countries that are more industrialized are also richer. Okay, countries that are more industrialized are also richer. I will give reasons why this is so as we proceed, okay, in the course of next 2, 3, 4 lectures. But this evidence is incontrovertible. Okay. I have about 25 more minutes to wrap up this lecture. Okay, let's see. Okay, there are various ways in which you can measure inequality. You know, all I've said till now is that there is inequality. Okay? But how much inequality? Is inequality falling? Is it increasing? How do we know that? Okay? And one way of doing it could be to just look at ratio of per capita incomes, okay, or comparing only the richest with the poorest, okay. For example, you know, this is one ratio that economists often use. It's called the 10% ratio or the 5% ratio. Okay, average income of the top 5% of the population divided by the average income of the bottom 5% of the population. That's one indicator of inequality, right? Or average income of the top 1% of the population divided by average income of bottom 1 or bottom 10% of total population. Okay? So, ratio of extremes. That's one way of measuring inequality, right? And then there's another indicator that economists often use. It's called Gini coefficient. Okay? Gini coefficient. G-I-N-I, Gini coefficient. Okay.